all of you, and today we are going to discuss about organic manures. And in this we have a variety of manures: farmyard manure, compost, green manures, crop residues, and so on. So definitely it is very, very important part, this green manure, organic manure. And we are losing lot of organic matter in our villages, in our towns, in our cities. In cities, we have municipal waste, solid waste, and also liquid waste. In urban rural areas, we have animal dung, we have many other valuable resources, crop residues. So these organic resources are very, very important. The recovery of organic resources is very limited. And also the quality of organic resources is not good. Farmers using farmyard manure, they are not sure how much effective it is, because our handling and management of farmyard manure is not good. So more than half of the nitrogen and partly sulfur and phosphorus, potassium, many nutrients are lost from the farmyard manure or other manures because of poor handling. So we need to improve the method of collection, method of application of manures, so that we can use this very valuable resource. So today we are going to discuss the meaning of organic manure, sources, what are the sources from which we can make organic manures, and classification of organic manures, and get some understanding about farmyard manure. Today we will discuss farmyard manure in detail, and how it is prepared, how it is handled, and how it is used in the field. And also know the losses, variety of losses occur from FIM, and we need to prevent those losses. So these are the things which we are going to discuss now. And you many times you will hear term organic amendment. So organic amendment is actually equivalent to organic manures. In Western countries, in European countries, they prefer to call organic amendment, because for them, these nutrients are not important. For them, the physical condition of the soil is more important. Of course, if you use organic amendment, you are also supplying nutrients. So many times the organic amendments are almost equivalent to organic manures. Additives used for improving the physical condition of the soil or to improve plant nutrition are your organic amendments. And examples, same as you have organic manures. Another term you will come across is organic biostimulants. So sometimes they are also called as agricultural or agriculture biostimulants. So these are actually substances. They are not providing any nutrients, but they are providing to stimulate the release and uptake of nutrients, and indirectly they can increase or improve the growth of the plants by producing certain hormones, by supplying certain hormones. So organic biostimulants are the substances or microbes applied to plants or rhizosphere. One can directly spray on the plants, or one can apply into the soil to stimulate natural processes to benefit nutrient uptake, nutrient use efficiency, tolerance to abiotic stress. This is also important, and crop quality. Humic acids, seaweed extracts, beneficial bacteria and fungi, etc., are used as organic biostimulants. So these are related terms to organic manures. Organic manures are actually plant and animal waste or products used as a source of plant nutrients, and they release the nutrients after decomposition or mineralization. And now it is important to see different sources from where we can get this organic matter or organic manures or raw material. Raw material to prepare manures are cattle shed waste. You know about in our Indian system or any system, you keep your capitals in home or maybe little away from the home or farm, and they give you dung, urine, and also biogas slurry can also be prepared from the cow dung. Human habitation waste are also there, mostly from the urban areas. Night soil, human urine, town refuse, and sewage sludge and sludge. I think you are aware of the sewage sludge, but sludge, you can know the sludge. Sludge is also known as grey water. The spelling is G-R-A-Y or G-R-E-Y. Both spellings work. Grey water, and it is wastewater generated from the households or office building. is your sludge, S-U-L-L-A-G, sludge, also called as grey water. So this is also a use of nutrients or useful nutrient source. Then you have poultry litters, dropping of sheep, goat, your horses. There are a variety of animals spread in different parts of our country, and so many animals are there, they can give you dung. Slaughterhouses waste are also important, where you kill the animals are slaughtered, and then the bones and the meat and blood meal or horn and hoof meal and also fish waste. So these are also organic sources. Byproducts of agro industries. We have number of agro industries where we get byproducts like oil cakes, bagasse from sugar cane, and press mud also from sugar cane, fruit and vegetable processing waste, and it can also include your household waste. Household waste are also used for making compost or manure. Crop waste, you are aware about the crop waste or crop residues. Water hyacinth or many other weeds can be used as making compost, and green manures are there. So these are 8 important sources from which we make organic manures. And we classify organic manures into 2, bulky organic manure and concentrated organic manure. Bulky organic manures are the manures which contain nutrients in very small proportion, and examples are farmyard manure, compost, and green manure. Means comparatively the nutrient concentration is less in bulky organic manure. Concentrated organic manure have slightly higher concentration of nutrients. That means, for example, the CN ratio in bulky organic manures will be wider than the CN ratio of concentrated organic manures. Concentrated organic manures mainly include your oilseed cakes and your certain animal products. And then advantages are very well known to you, advantages of bulky organic manures or farmyard manure. They improve physical, chemical, biological properties of the soil. They increase the availability of native nutrients. Carbon dioxide released, it acts as a CO2 fertilizer. Means it will enhance photosynthesis when the CO2 is released. Enhanced microbial activity and plant parasitic nematodes and fungi are controlled. There are, friends, many examples where these organic manures have been found useful in killing or suppressing the disease-causing nematodes or fungi in the crops, because there are many pathogens which are soil-borne. So those kind of pathogens are killed by carbon dioxide or certain other compounds released from the manures. So it has been very well proved that manures have disease-suppressing abilities in soil. Now, concentrated organic manures have relatively higher nutrient concentration, especially of NPK, than bulky organic manures. They're made from raw material of plant or animal origin. Oil cakes are from plant origin, and blood meal, fish manure, etc. are from animal origin. And sometimes these animal products are also called as organic fertilizers. In European countries, they call them like bone meal, they call it organic fertilizer. It is just by convention they are calling it. It may or may not be truly organic, but it is the prefix they use. Fish manure, they call it organic fertilizer. And relatively, they are slow acting, but supply nitrogen for a longer period. This is important. Now we discuss in detail about farmyard manure. So it is actually, if we want to define farmyard manure, it is decomposed mixture of dung and urine of farm animals. Farm animals, any animal, along with the litter, bedding material, and leftover material from roughages or fodder fed to the cattle. So many times unused fodder remains, that is also incorporated into the things, and it is converted into farmyard manure. So these are the basic raw material for making farmyard manure, including cow dung, including the bedding material, and third one is leftover fodder. And newly collected and stored FIM is termed as fresh farmyard manure. And once it is matured, or once it is decomposed and matured, then it is called as matured compost It is farmyard manure, matured farmyard manure. And now, on an average, FIM contains 0.5% nitrogen, 0.2% phosphorus, P2O5, and 0.5% K2O. This is general composition based upon fresh weight basis. If you make it a dry weight basis, it will increase. Urine contains 1% nitrogen, cow urine, and 1.35% K2O. Nitrogen present in urine is mostly in urea form. That is important. And other day I told you that this urea was separated by some scientists. Even during storage, the nutrients are lost due to leaching and volatilization. This is issue. And there are many other feeders of cow dung. They reduce the quantity of farmyard manure because they eat dung. They are dung eaters. So dung beetle is there, and that can, many of you must have seen in the evening time, night time, when they make the roll of the cow dung and then take it to the far away places. And they lay eggs in these rolls, or sometimes they make burrow in the earth, and they keep it, they store it for future. You know, it is being used as a food also, and it is also used by them as a breeding ground or breeding place. So this dung beetle is there. And another is green bottle flies. They also consume some part of the dung from the animal. And you see the composition of raw materials. Actually, the raw material will determine the quality or the nutrient value of farmyard manure. If your material is initially rich in nutrients, then you will get nutrient-rich manure, farmyard manure. So these are the examples. You can see cattle dung and urine mix contain 0.6% nitrogen, 0.15% phosphorus, 0.45% potash. So at least you can remember for cattle, how much is the NPK in cattle dung and urine mixture. And similarly, NPK in fresh excreta of farm animals. It is just, for example, if it is urine, 1% nitrogen, 1.3% K2. And there is no phosphorus in cow urine or in other animals also. Phosphorus is in very trace amount, not significant amount. Now let us see how much dung and urine is produced by different animals. Just to have some idea how much dung is produced. So cow produces about 272, if it is the weight of the cow, it can give you 7,324. Means you can say 7 tons. 7 tons of excreta it can give us, and total urine is 2,000 tons, and then total dung is 5,000 tons, you can say. So 5 plus 2 is equal to 7. Total excreta is 7 tons per animal. And this is per head annually. In 1 year, one cow can give you 7 tons of excreta, including 2 tons of urine and 5 tons of dung. And if you convert it in terms of nutrients, then quantity of nutrients produced by the livestock, kg per head annually. So cow, for example, its dung can give you 20 kg nitrogen, 10 kg P2O5, and 5 kg K2O. And you can multiply it by the number of animals kept by farmer. So this is really very significant amount of nutrients. And you also know other benefits of FYM. It is not just nutrient, there are so many benefits. So now we will see what are the different methods of preparation of FYM. It is mostly pit method, trench method, and heap method. There are 3 methods. In pit method and trench method, there is no much difference. Only difference is in the size of the pit or trench. Almost same. And heap method is quite common in India. So in pit method, you have pit sizes 8 meter by 2 meter wide and 1 meter deep, and filled in layers by the mixture of dung, urine, and litter up to about 50 centimeter above ground. Means just you go on adding the bedding material, dung, everything, and when it reaches 50 centimeter above the ground, then it is time to plaster it. And after plastering, you just leave it and it will mature in 6 months time. And usually it is 10 to 12 tons FYM per pit will be prepared if your pit size is 8 by 2 by 1 cubic meter. And one animal can give you on an average 5 to 6 tons of farmyard manure per year. So this is pit method. Almost same method is your trench method given by Dr. C.N. Acharya. 6 to 8 meter into 1.5 to 2 meter. Now it is a bit deeper than the previous. In previous it was, it is almost same. 6 to 8 meter into 1.5 to 2 meter into 1 to 1.25 meter. This is size. And mixture of dung, urine, soaked litter is deposited in layers until it becomes 50 centimeter above the ground layer. And then covered. And manure is ready in about 160 days. So this pit method and trench method, they are almost same. And now heap method, the most common method you must have seen. If anybody has visited village, these kind of heaps will welcome you when you enter the village. Outside the village, they make such kind of heaps, and which are really not very scientific, and they are not hygienic also. And most commonly used by farmers, sweepings, cow dung and litter are collected and heaped at any fixed place. Sweepings are means when you broom an area, jhadu lagate hain, sweeping in respect of your goat or sheep, etc. And it takes 6 to 9 months, a little longer, and 30 to 35% nitrogen, 20 to 25% phosphorus, and 4 to 6% K is lost due to leaching, washing, and volatilization. This is the serious problem, that nutrient losses are very high from this. Now, what factors will determine the composition of farmyard manure? This question is usually asked from the students. So number one is kind of animal. Just a few slides back, you have seen that different animals are producing different quantity of the manures, different quantity of the dung, and also the composition of NPK was different. So animal which is giving you richer dung will definitely, you will get rich farmyard manure. So for example, this poultry or your goats or sheep, their dung is richer in NPK than your ordinary cow or buffalo. Age and condition of the animal means your aged animal. Aged animal consume or utilize very less fraction of nutrients in their canal, alimentary canal. So most of the nutrients come out. So manure from aged animal will give you more nutrients than from the young or adult animal. Function of the animal. Function of the animal means what kind of function it is doing. If it is a bullock, if it is a milching cow, so manure of milching cow will be poor in NPK than a bullock, because a lot of nutrients are required to make the milk. And also condition of the animal, you can see that if an animal is just doing nothing, it is staying in home, then its manure will be richer than animal who is working hard, who is being used to plow the land or some other work. Kind of feed and fodder. It definitely, if your animal is getting nitrogenous or leguminous kind of fodder, legume fodder, your cowpea fodder, your barseem fodder, compared to animals who are getting cereal fodder, the manure will be definitely richer if it gets richer food. Manner of storage, your pit method, trench method will give you more nutrient content than your heap method. Nature of litter. Nature of litter means if your litter is from, say, bajra or your some cereal kind of litter, then it will give you less nutrient. If you have litter, leguminous litter, or some kind of litter which is rich in nutrients, the manure will be rich in nutrients. So they are simple explanation, and you can see NPK content of different residues. So according to that, you will have bedding material, and the manure richness will be decided by the kind of residue bedding material. So in this, the composition is given. More the nutrient in residue, better will be the manure. Now losses, variety of losses may occur in FYM during handling. You must have seen that a lot of urine remains uncollected. It is not that bedding material is provided to the animal round the year. In some places you have pakka floors, cemented floors, where generally urine is not collected by the farmers, and it goes away. And sometimes they have kaccha floor, means just made of earth. In that cases, it is soaked by the earth. So this bedding material is primarily used by farmers in winter season. So therefore, in winter season, urine is collected nicely. But in other seasons, summer season or rainy season, these bedding materials are not used. So then urine will be lost. Similarly, dung is also lost. If your cattle, animals are going outside the home to the field, so many times their dung is lost. And during storage, when you make a heap or pit, you have variety of losses. Certain losses can be minimized. Definitely certain losses can be minimized during storage, like just changing the method of preparation. And also during application, a variety of losses occurs in application, and that can also be minimized simple by giving some care in incorporating the manure in the field. So now let us see urine. Many times we fail to recover or retain the urine. Losses in field can also occur. And ammonia volatilization is the major loss. During the decomposition, you know, if you have nitrogenous material, that is converted into ammonia finally, and it can be lost. And also there is urea, you know, urea in the urine, that can be easily volatilized. And you can see the reaction, urea in urine, and it takes water and it is converted to ammonium carbonate, the hydrolysis. We call it urea hydrolysis. And then ammonium carbonate can release your ammonia. So it can go outside. Many times if you visit an animal place where animals are kept, you will find some smell. That smell is from ammonia. And also significant part of dung is lost in making the cow dungs, so cow dung cakes. Animals go out for grazing, sometimes you lose. And 2/3 of the dung is either utilized for making cow dung. That is important loss, but also it may be good for some and bad for some. Bad for making manure, but good for making food in the houses. People use it as a fuel material. So you can see this picture, very common in our country. People do it. And also they store it in these kind of structures. It is just to show, some of you may not have seen it. However, many of you must have seen these pictures. They store these dung cakes in these places and use them round the year. And then losses during storage. So storage means when you prepare the manure in pit or in heaps. So manure heaps in an open space outside the village, exposed to the sun and rain. If it is not covered, mostly it is not covered, and it is unprotected from the rains. And definitely nutrients are lost. They are washed away. They are washed away. And leaching can also happen. Due to rainfall, about 50% N and P and 90% K is water soluble. And soluble organic acids and other constituents are lost from the manure. Losses by leaching will vary with the surface exposed, how much area is exposed, the intensity of the rainfall, and the slope of the land. More slope means more loss. Volatilization, I think you understand what is volatilization. It is loss of nitrogen in the form of ammonia from the manure. Manure, certain constituents are converted into ammonical form, that is directly lost, or from urea, it is also lost, this ammonia. Now, improved method of handling FYM to prevent nutrient losses. So first thing is that it should be
Sorry, your microphone is mute condition.
Not audible, sir. Not.
Please unmute your microphone.
Hello, can you hear now?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Okay, thank you. So we continue with the improved method of handling FIM to prevent nutrient losses. We need to prevent them, and usually undecomposed manure should be avoided. Undecomposed manure may have some disease causing organism like Salmonella, and it can have some weed seeds, and it can invite more termite infestation. So undecomposed manure should not be used, and definitely certain use of chemical preservative is suggested to trap this ammonia. And gobar gas plant is another option for efficient handling of the farmyard manure. So you can see chemical preservative can be added to FIM to decrease nitrogen losses via ammonia. Preservatives are applied in the cattle shed, directly in the cattle shed. When you use bedding material, in that you apply certain preservatives. Preservatives are gypsum and single superphosphate. These are the two important preservatives that can be used. And you can see how they recover or how they stop the losses of ammonia. For example, if it is gypsum and ammonium carbonate is there after hydrolysis of urea, and then it can react and it makes your ammonium sulfate. So ammonium sulfate is stable. It will not be lost easily. And then you can save this, reduce this volatilization losses. Another option is, and that is more efficient option, is to convert cow dung or other organic, certain other organic waste into gobar gas or biogas. And biogas, you understand, it is made up of methane. 50 to 70% is methane, and 30 to 40% range is carbon dioxide and some other trace gases. So it is really useful, and you can see it is rich in nutrients like 1.4% nitrogen in biogas slurry. Slurry is the byproduct. Once your gas is extracted, the remaining part can be used as a manure. We call it biogas slurry. 1.4, 1 and 0.8% NPK. You can see it is much far richer than your FIM. And then uses are fuel. Definitely fuel can be, fuel is there for cooking or lighting in rural areas. Manure can be used as, slurry can be used as manure, and solving sanitation problems. Definitely it helps in the hygienic conditions. And this is just one picture. On the left side, you can see this is biogas slurry. It is semi-solid and it is rich in NPK, and narrow CN ratio is very narrow. CN ratio of biogas slurry becomes narrow because nitrogen percent increases. So in this case, you can see it can be directly used in the field. Some farmers are very, very intelligent, and they use it with irrigation water. In sugarcane crop, I have seen farmers use it fresh. So this is better option. On the right side, this is the gobar gas plant. And then Avasthi 1975, it's not new, this gobar gas plant is very old. He suggested certain advantage of biogas slurry. It is quite rich in N and then the original ingredients. Also contain phosphate, potash, sulfur, and number of micronutrients. Biogas slurry is extremely cheap and is made by locally available material. Prolonged use of organic manure maintains and builds up soil fertility. So improved method of handling farmyard manure to prevent nutrient losses. Sufficient moisture in soil at application time. If you want good response, there should be moisture in the soil. Otherwise, further decomposition and release of nutrients will not happen. Well powdered, as far as possible, it should be powder. It should be not be in thick or bigger pieces. The pieces should be small so that it solubilizes or mixes. Mixing is necessary. Mixing with soil is necessary for this FIM. And about 30% nitrogen, 60 to 70% P, and 70% K available to the first crop. Okay, it may not take, but it is available in available form. And it ends this presentation. Now we will have another small presentation on so if you have any question on general question on classification of manure or farmyard manure, how it is made and what are the factors that will influence the composition of farmyard manure and handling or making or preparation. So if you have question, you are free to ask. Any question? If not, now we will see some other manures like sheep and goat manure. They are definitely farm animals, sheep and goat, poultry manure, you know. And also we will see compost, how compost is made. So in this case, let us take sheep and goat manure and their droppings. Droppings are rich in nutrients than farmyard manure and compost. It may contain 3% nitrogen, 1% phosphorus and 2% K2. Very easy to remember. 3, 1, 2. Sweeping of sheds are placed in pits for decomposition. It is not that like FYM, you need to make compost it. You need to decompose it. And then sheep penning is also a practice by some farmers. Particularly sheep and goats are kept overnight in the field. They take to the field, allow them to stay there, and they leave their droppings. And those droppings can be directly mixed into the soil. So that way, they are directly incorporated into the soil. This is known as sheep penning. And then poultry manure. Poultry manure is further rich in NPK and solid and liquid excreta. You cannot separate them. It is semi-solid. Are excreted together, resulting in no urine loss. The nutrient content of unprocessed poultry manure deteriorates quickly. It is important that the losses are very quick from this manure. If left exposed, 50% nitrogen loss within 30 days. Composting can be done. Composting of the excreta can be done. And it has been investigated as a method of stabilizing poultry litter and manure. And now people are selling in the market some chicken manure pellets for some city areas, for urban people. These chicken manure pellets are available. And then composting has advantage. Composting of this poultry waste or chicken waste is very, very important because you get very foul smell from this or foul odor. So we need to compost it. And there are advantages of composting: reduced volume, odors, and you will not get much odors. Fly attraction is reduced, and weed seed viability. You can kill the weeds. So composting poultry manure under anaerobic conditions helps to for greater recovery of final product and negligible loss of nutrients, particularly that of nitrogen. So in case of poultry, anaerobic composting is suggested. And now you will have manure which is 3% nitrogen, 2.6% phosphorus and 1.4% K2O. So definitely in India, the recovery of poultry compost or poultry material is missing part. We need to do it more judiciously, more effectively, so that we get maximum recovery. Lot of wastage is there for this poultry. And now the most important and last part of today's lecture is compost or composting. So first question comes, why there is need to go for composting? And before that, I think you know our crop residues, our leaves, our any plant material which is considered as waste can be composted. Similarly, in urban area, city area, you have night soil, human excreta and variety of other household products, waste, those all can be composted. The only thing is that method of composting will vary. For rural composting, we prefer indoor method. For urban composting, we prefer Bangalore method, which is anaerobic method. And there are at least 100 kind of different composting method. More than 100 kind of composting methods are available, and we will see only the important ones. So first question comes, why there is need for composting? So actually we want to recover the nutrients, whatever are there in the raw material, crop residues or any organic material. And then another objective is reducing the CN ratio of organic material so that the nutrient availability increases. Otherwise, one can directly mix these residues into the soil. Why there is need for composting? It is to reduce the CN ratio and increase the solubility of insoluble or less soluble nutrients, fertilizer. Sometimes what happens, for example, if you have rock phosphate, and we know it is citrate insoluble. So if we want to increase the solubility of phosphate from the rock phosphate, then we can mix it in this so that it gets solubilized. At least part of it will be solubilized. Availability will increase. And definitely organic farming. all these organic farming are organic manures are the mainstay of organic farming. You need organic sources of nutrients in organic farming, and not just in organic farming. Even in conventional farming, you must have seen the recommendation of long-term manural trials. They also say that you need to supply 50% nutrients from NPK and 50% nutrient from organic manures. It is recommendation of long-term fertilizer experiment. So even in conventional farming, you need organic manures. And in organic farming, it cannot be done without organic manures. So they are very, very important and keeps a valuable resource out of the landfill. Lot of organic resources in city areas are going waste. But if we can compost them, we can make them valuable resource. Helps protect the environment. You see, if you use manure, you will need less fertilizer. So fertilizer production pollutes the environment, and fertilizer use also pollute the environment. So we can avoid that kind of, and also it is hygienic also to convert these organic waste into manure. And it promotes biodiversity. You have seen that how these organic manures promote soil biodiversity. So these are the purpose. And if we see the recovery of nutrients from crop residues, you know, when we grow crops, so part of nutrients is harvested in economic product. That is your grain, mostly grain or other economic part. But remaining part of the crops will have lot of nutrients. So the field crops residue exceed the grain or any other economic produce. This is one. The content of plant nutrients other than NPS is more in crop residues than in grain or economic part. You know, and nitrogen, phosphorus, sulfur is more, total is more in grains. And for other nutrients are more in straw than in grains, like potassium. 70% to 80% of the total potassium uptake goes to residues. You will see later. Or K content in residues could be 59% to 88%, or you can say 60% to 90% of the total K is removed by crops. So very important to recycle these residues to supply potassium. The content of secondary and micronutrients in crop residues may also be 80% to 90%. See, of the total removal by the crop. You don't need fertilizer to supply these nutrients, secondary nutrients. And you can see in this NPK in residues or extra of different crops. So in rice, 33 phosphorus and 87% K in residue. Means roughly 40% nitrogen and 1/3 of phosphorus and 87% of potassium is in residues. So we can recycle it and see the other cases also. Examples are given. So recycling of crop residues is very, very important if you want back your nutrients. If it is not done by incorporating residue, then we can make at least compost and return back those residues. So the reducing the CN ratio of organic material through composting. Sorry. Most crop residues have a CN ratio wider than 50. Sometimes it may be 80:1, 90:1. Soil microbes in general require 30 parts of carbon and 1 part of nitrogen. 30:1 for their growth. This is ideal ratio for them, where they can multiply very fast. When crop residues or other materials of a CN ratio wider than 30 are incorporated in soil, soil microbe utilize native soil nitrogen for their growth, and this creates a temporary nitrogen hunger. I think you know about nitrogen immobilization. CN ratio of some crop residues. See, in case of rice, carbon is 41% and nitrogen is 0.46%. So CN ratio is about 90. CN ratio in rice residues is 90:1. In wheat, it is 124:1. That means rice contains more nitrogen than your wheat residues. Because in wheat residues, most of the nitrogen is diverted towards grain, which contain more protein than rice. So therefore, rice extra have more nitrogen. So you can see for other crops also, CN ratio is very wide. except the, if you see for legumes, it becomes little narrow. So reducing CN ratio of organic material, if legumes with low CN ratio are added to feed, the excess nitrogen which is not utilized by the crop is also lost. Means it, this point suggests that composting is not just for cereal crop residue, but it is good for legume residues also. Because if you use legume residues directly into the soil, part of their nitrogen can be easily mineralized and which can be lost to the environment. So if we want to preserve nitrogen from the leguminous plants, they also can should be composted. That is the message. So to overcome these problems, crop residues are composted for reducing their CN ratio. Thus, composting is a process. This is the definition of composting. Composting is a process by which the CN ratio of crop residues and other organic material is brought down to between 10:1 to 15:1. This definition is given by Dr. Rajendra Prasad. So you will find similar definitions. The main purpose is to reduce the carbon content, to reduce the carbon content and increase the mineral content. So composting process, there are variety of composting process, and it is mostly microbiological decomposition of organics into a stable amorphous brown to dark brown humus-like material in 3 to 6 months. You know, ultimate product is humus. Organic residues undergo intensive decomposition under thermophilic and mesophilic. So there are two stages in composting process. One is thermophilic, other is mesophilic. So first it will be mesophilic condition, and then it will be thermophilic condition, means rise in temperature. And heterotrophic microorganisms such as bacteria, fungi, actinomycetes are actively involved in the process of decomposition. And composting process is of two types, anaerobic and aerobic composting. Anaerobic composting means you do not allow oxygen to enter, and it is anaerobic process, and there is no turning of the organic material in the heap. And wherever in aerobic composting, you allow oxygen to enter to aid the or help the composting process. And aerobic conditions are created by turning the residues. So now let us see anaerobic composting. The basic purpose of anaerobic composting was to decompose the municipal solid waste, MSW, which are generated in towns or city areas. So it was proposed by C.N. Acharya and from Indian Institute of Science, Bangalore. Decomposition occurs in the absence or limited supply of oxygen. Farm waste and town refuse. Under both conditions, you can use it, but is generally developed for making town compost, compost in the urban areas. Pits are made away from the town to avoid the bad odors. You cannot make compost in the city centers. You need to go outside the city. The depth of pits is 1 meter, while the length and breadth of pits depends upon the amount of city refuse. It can be variable. The length and breadth can be variable. Pits are made at a distance of 1.5 to 2 meters. Mean a distance between two pits should be 1.5 to 2 meters. First layer of 15 centimeter layer of vegetable material and other city refuse is laid. Thereafter, 5 centimeter layer of human excreta is laid. This sequence of layering is followed until pits are filled 30 centimeter above the ground. So you need to repeat this process, 15 centimeter refuse, then 5 centimeter human excreta, and this sequence is repeated until it becomes 30 centimeter above the ground. And then if somebody does not like to use human excreta, then soil mixed with urine can be substituted for human excreta. Unlike aerobic composting, no turning is required here because it is anaerobic condition, and manure is prepared in 5 to 6 months. So here anaerobic organism dominate and oxidation of carbon is not complete. So in this case, certain phytotoxic materials are also produced, and also sometimes odor is not good in this case, because it is anaerobic decomposition process. And in this case, another limitation is that weed seeds will not die because it is not very hot conditions. So it is just moderately hot. it is not too high. Temperature is not too high in this. Under aerobic conditions, temperatures are very high. Under anaerobic conditions, temperatures are low. So your weed seeds may not die, and many pathogens may not die. A variety of pathogens can come from manure to human beings. So this is the demerit of this. For example, as compared to aerobic process, where the release of energy is very high, means 484 to 674 kilocalorie per gram molecule of glucose. So here the energy release is very high in aerobic process, and you can say it is just 26 kilocalorie of energy per gram molecule of glucose. So you can see the difference. So therefore, it is a bit cooler process. These anaerobic process take longer than aerobic composting. Now, aerobic composting arrangement of arrangement for exposing the composting material to oxygen is made. You need to turn it. Aerobic microbes break down organic matter and produce CO2, ammonia, water, heat, and humus. These are the decomposition products. Intermediate compounds produced are further oxidized, so no risk of phytotoxicity. Heat generated destroys many human or plant pathogens and kills weed seeds. Friends, over years, many diseases have been found to spread from the compost. Heat generated destroys many pathogens. Loss of more nutrients, especially nitrogen, can happen and preferred over anaerobic process, this aerobic composting. So these are the organisms which can be killed in aerobic composting. You can see. So you can see yourself, the temperature can go up to 65 degrees centigrade in this. And much before 65 degrees centigrade, many of the pathogens which can cause diseases in human being are killed in this process. So you can see Salmonella, Typhosa, so. And these are many organisms like Cyanobacterium, diphtheria, it can be killed at 55 degrees centigrade temperature and so on. So you can see this. So initially for first 2 to 3 days, the temperature in the pit is around 20 to 45 degrees centigrade. And mesophilic organisms multiply. So this is mesophilic phase. And they generate heat by their own metabolism and raise the temperature to 50 to 70 degrees centigrade. Means these mesophilic organisms raise the temperature to 50 to 70 degrees centigrade and die. At this temperature, they will die. And then the new group of bacteria will come, or fungi will come, that are tolerant to this temperature. They are thermophilic. So these thermophilic will come and survive and do the job. Whatever materials remain, like lignin, they will decompose that material. So this heat kills pathogens and weeds also. So you can see these species, which species are responsible for decomposition. For example, mesophilic, in bacteria, you have this list, and fungi, fusarium, this, these are the names. You need not to bother, just to expose to you that
Now
it is. So it is just to show you that these are the organisms. This is the list. You can have a look on this. You need not to mug up everything. Just get some idea that these are the important fungus and bacteria that are responsible for decomposition process. So you cannot count them. This is really very short list. I just selected certain, I shortlisted it. And then thermotolerant and thermophilic. Bacteria like Bacillus, I don't know how to read it. And you can see very difficult spellings of these fungi and actinomycin. After active composting stage is followed by a curing stage. And the pit's temperature declines gradually. Then the third and final phase will come, which is called as curing or maturity phase, where the temperature will slow down. And at this stage, another group of thermophilic fungi start to grow. And these fungi decompose cellulose and hemicellulose. So biochemical composition of some crop residues is given in table 3. So at the last, these material like cellulose, hemicellulose, lignins, etc. will be decomposed during the curing process. And two types of compost are there, rural compost and urban compost. So these were the method of composting. Now people have classified compost also. Rural compost means compost which is made in villages. Urban compost means which is made in city centers or towns. So rural compost mostly uses crop residues, cattle dung. However, urban compost uses city refuse, including kitchen waste, industrial waste, waste material from the vegetable market and so on. And friends, I can tell you a lot of NGOs and agencies are involved in producing city compost. Now, government is giving some subsidies to NGOs and to the people who are producing city compost. Maybe 1,000 rupees per ton, something like that. Subsidy is being given by the government to produce this city compost. And then they can sell it also. So you can see this data, this is production of compost and vermicompost in Indian states. So this data is little bit old, but I did not find the new data also. So you can have some idea. The quantity of Karnataka is the leading state, which produces highest quantity of rural compost, around 26 million tons in 10-11. And then Chhattisgarh and Odisha. This is sequence of the state. In All India basis, we produce 79 million tons of compost, rural compost, not a big deal. Similarly, in urban composting also Karnataka leads. Karnataka leads 4.6 million tons of compost, urban compost. Similarly, vermicompost. In vermicompost, Kerala leads, it is 5.5 million tons. And then West Bengal, Chhattisgarh, Karnataka. So I really don't have any source which can give us latest data. If any student come across this, if you find any source where we can get this data of compost production, vermicompost production in the country, kindly share with us. And general rural composting process are like Indore process. Just I am giving you the list. I will not go into the details. Mayadas process, Coimbatore process. I have sent you a book where all these procedures are explained. On-farm composting methods, book is by Food and Agriculture Organization, where all these methods have been described in detail. Those who are interested can see it. There are rapid composting processes also, like Chinese high temperature rural composting, quick process, and then effective microbes technology, EM technology has also come. Accelerated composting has also come. Other methods are like your enriched compost, NADAP compost, and this list is endless. You can go on adding. Every third person will make compost by his own name. Dinesh compost, Suresh compost, like there are so many methods. So large scale or mechanical composting is there. These are practiced in developed countries where they go for windrow composting, passively aerated windrows. They use machines to do this job. Aerated static pile, bin composting, rectangular agitated beds, silos, and rotating drums. So these are large scale mechanical composting. In our IRI also, our institute is doing composting, and anybody interested can visit the biomass utilization unit run by the institute. And you can see these kind of piles are there. These kind of rows are there. These rows are called as wind rows, where the material is composted. So you can visit, and you can also see vermicomposting unit in IRE, right in IRE. So, and this is almost ready-made from the same windrows. You can see this kind of manure is finally prepared. It is a compost. In IRE, you must have seen this tractor and trolley running through the roads and they are collecting leaves. So we also make leaf compost. So this is leaf compost, friend, looking like soil, but it is actually leaf compost. You can go there to the biomass utilization unit and see it. And these are the composition of different kind of compost. You can see them from FAO, this data is there. And also nutritive value of raw and compost square pith in southern states of India, in some western parts of Maharashtra. They make this wherever your coconut is there. So they make square pith manure. And also some people make sugarcane trash compost is also made. And press mud can be composted. Many farmers like to do composting of the press mud. So you can see it is rich in nitrogen, 1 to 1.5%, phosphorus 1.4 to 2.5, 2%. So Pressmud is from sugarcane industry. And then nutritive value of poultry waste compost, nitrogen 1.89, phosphorus 1.83, potassium 1.34. So this makes or this completes this presentation. And now your questions are welcome. And I am really thankful to Dr. Shive again for his valuable time and attention. And thank you to all. So your questions are invited. You can ask your questions, please. Hello. Yes. Hello.
Yes.